And yes, here we are, Espresso Sesh, another episode, another Tuesday. It's April 30th today. My name is Nino Musco. I'm here every Tuesday with you for Espresso Sesh, and I have the honor and the pleasure to introduce my guest today, Jef Stott. Welcome, Jef. Your mic is on.
Hi. Thank you so much, man.
Welcome to Espresso Sesh, best frequencies forever. How are you doing today,
man? I'm great. I love it here. This is my first time here, and this place is fantastic. Excuse me, I'm
Yeah, let's set it up. Let's put some music in the background.
Everything's cool.
Yeah, we just started here. Like, yo,
I love this spot.
San Francisco style, huh? Like we say.
I know. Old school San Francisco.
Yeah, the Secret Alley. Shut up.
Right?
Shut up.
Yeah, I don't know if anybody's ever been in this place before, but it's kind of like a pirate ship, kind of cabaret sort of place, you know?
Yeah, dreamy and visionary, you know?
Uh-huh,
Creative place, you know, like give room to creativity, you know?
So what do you, you got your production room here, and then what are the other things you guys do in this spot?
So this is the live studio for the BFF station, then across the street, right in front, there is the recording studio for pre-recorded show. So there are some live show and some pre-recorded.
Great.
And then in this floor, there is an artist studio, video production. There is the performance space with a kitchen. There is an arcade room that you can, there are video games. That you can have a monthly subscription and have access 24/7.
Great.
For free. Play for free. There is a yoga studio. There is a legal team. Yeah, you know,
amazing.
You name it. And there are some offices they are constructing right now. So keep going. No,
it's great.
Evolving.
Yeah.
Evolving.
Well, I'm glad to know about it, and I hope to come back sometime.
I think it's a place that you fit this place very well. No?
Yeah.
Like, you know.
Yeah, we were talking like, you know, I hate to keep saying this, but like back in the day, so, you know, because I had a studio at Cell Space, you know, in the Mission for many years. And I lived at 20th and Shotwell for a while. And then, you know, Baobab's closing.
Baobab actually closed.
We don't even need to go into all that stuff. But, you know, but this reminds me of the good stuff, you know, like Red Poppy Art House, you know, Cell Space, these warehouses that are so important, you know. And I'm just so glad you guys are still here.
You're still here, still here. Thriving, you know, BFF is a nice reality, you know, came out from nothing and 5 years old and going for the 6 year steady and solid.
It's great.
Cool. So we just listened to Osiris, your latest single.
Brand new, came
out. Shout out to Momo Siva. Where is coming
people.
From? Where is coming from? Where is this music from?
So,
Jef Stott. This music, he made this music.
Hey, everybody, how's it going to the video world?
The radio world also, because we are on the radio first.
So, man. So that's a brand new track. It just came out last week, actually, and on Friday. So it's just a couple days old. Kind of returning back to my roots, you know, of the kind of like more tribal ethno dub sort of sound, you know, that I'm known for. So I'm distributing my work through Six Degrees still, but this came out on my own label called Embarca Records. And it's just, you know, a brand new track that I put together. Just, you know, it came out quickly, actually. I just finished it like a month ago and just mastered it.
And you must have
done
it.
Done. Sometimes, you know, you work on tracks for like a long time and they don't go anywhere, and the other ones just pop out real fast, you know. And that was one that came out real fast.
Yeah, sometimes the track needs some time, like a wind, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
To sit there and wait for the right moment to be picked, you know, and edited and finished.
Yeah.
Yeah, like you said, this ethno dub. No, you have elements of the world music, if we can call it that way.
Whatever.
Yeah,
I know.
To give us, you know, an example.
Yeah.
No?
Yeah.
And you know, you mix it together with the element of contemporary, like electronic music, dance music, but also for a spiritual aspect of music. It's kind of like your music is elevated, you know, it elevates you.
Thank you, man. I appreciate that. You know, it's like, you know, I've been doing this a long time, and we can talk about, you know, all the different things later, but so this music is similar to what other people are doing. You know, Desert Dwellers, you know, Gaudi, David Starfire, Chebby Sabah, you know, these guys. But we all kind of rose up together, you know.
Yeah.
And we just found, and it's one of the reasons why I love San Francisco so much, is one of these, I don't want to say melting pot, but intersection, you know,
yeah.
the crossroads, like where a lot of different people are here, like overlapping. And I really love that idea that different things are influencing the music, and then the music is influencing things, and there's like a cultural like conversation going on, you know.
And I
just feel that. So I'm a musical artist, so that's what I want to contribute to the world, is that sound.
But like you mentioned, San Francisco in particular, probably in this genre, in this scene, was very influential because, first and foremost, like you mentioned, like Six Degrees records,
yeah.
Chubby Samba was here, operating here, you know, and also, you know, this is. Kind of the city of Burning Man, no? So
right.
this music is like a big outlet. Burning Man is a big outlet for this music.
Yeah, I had a really good good luck or good fortune to connect with the Hookah Dome, which was a Burning Man camp. And they were kind of just like a medium-sized camp. And then right when I connected with them, they sort of like got really big, like they kind of blew up. And we had everybody there on the playa for the first time all together. All the people you mentioned, you know, it's like David Starfire and Chevy Sabah, and then Bobby Friction came in from BBC, and all these people came in from India, and like all these people, and the sound was that global bass kind of sound on the playa with the, like the ritual, you know, belly dancers, tribal belly dance and fire and all this stuff. And then we had the hookahs inside and like the Middle Eastern like hospitality going on, you know, and it was such a beautiful, powerful thing to have out there at Burning Man. And then, you know, 5 years later, it kind of like wound down, you know, because like it's hard to keep that kind of size of camp going, you know.
It's a lot of work. Yeah. It's already a lot of work, Burning Man, but in a big
to keep that level. Yeah. So that was a very special time, you know, that was like in 2008 to like 2013. It was like really just great, you know. Yeah, so we brought that sound out, you know.
Yeah, I mean, it's still evolving, you know, like
totally.
It sounds like there was the golden era, and now it's it's kind of, no, but
well, now I'm with Opulent Temple, and they have this thing called Opulent Chill, and so that's their kind of down tempo version of their big camp. So I'm helping them with the music, and we're actually doing a stage at the How Weird Street Festival on Sunday. You know, just in a couple of days.
Is this Sunday?
Yeah.
On the 5th?
Uh-huh.
May 5th?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
So the How Weird Street Festival, we're going to have this, you know, massive stage with all the global-based people, tribal belly dance, and kind of more the ethno-dub sort of sound on Sunday at the big festival. So that'll be great. But at Burning Man, so now... you know, I think in a way, like almost people are wanting to return because it got kind of like Coachella for a minute, you know?
Yeah.
Right. And I think people, even the culture of Burning Man, they're trying to kind of tone it down a little bit and bring it back to its roots. Like they're starting to talk about like, okay, you can't have like a plug and play camp, you know, you got to kind of build your own thing, because that was like the vibe, you know? And so they're trying to bring it back.
Yeah. I mean, like, I've seen like containers home with AC. And
yeah.
It wasn't that. Yeah.
Yeah. I've always stayed in a tent. I've never even had an RV. I always stay. Yeah. I have a nice tent, but it's always a tent. Because I feel like that's... I always describe Burning Man as like a Hajj. You know, like to going to Mecca, you know, like the spiritual journey, the spiritual migration. For all of the freaks, like it's a Hajj to go to the desert, to go to Burning Man, you know. And I think there's something about having it be slightly difficult makes it more rewarding.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, because, you know, you get there and you have to find, sometimes there are like a dust storm, you don't see shit, you know, and you have to build your camp and this dust storm is coming, or you are performing and a dust storm is coming.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean, also, like you said, the reward is greater because once you get there, you know, you're going to,
I don't know. I mean, people that kind of just do it like a tourist kind of lifestyle, you know. I just say good luck with that, you know.
I mean, there is an airport you can fly in. You know, all the stuff. But, you know, definitely it's coming back to the global base scene and having such a festival, such an event like that in this area. So probably helped out. Huh?
Mm-hmm. Which one do you mean? How Weird or Burning Man?
No, Burning Man.
Yeah.
For the global
totally.
Base scene.
Yes. Yeah. Because, you know, I mean, Burning Man has the regional events in different cities around the world, but the home base is definitely here. And you can really feel it. Like, you can really feel at these, you know, like Folsom Street Fair was last weekend and Howard Street Fair, and there's always something going on that's touching that Burning Man culture in San Francisco. And it's just, it's beautiful, you know? It's a really, I'm still feeling like there's a lot of energy there.
And you are the artistic director of the Ukadon?
I was back in the day. Yeah, I was musical. Okay. I was one music of the musical directors. Yeah, okay, so yeah. I was programming all the DJs. And
but you are like you go to Burning Man like.
This will be my 20th year.
20th year, okay.
Yeah. I mean, I haven't gone 20 years in a row, but I started in '99.
Okay.
And I think I've been like 15 times.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean it's I've been myself 6 times.
Great.
So, yeah, I love it. So.
Yeah. So, do you have any like camp or, you know, people?
No, I go with friends. We do like a small camp with a Sicilian flag.
Okay, great. That's awesome. Yeah. Very good.
Yeah, and enjoy the experience. Yeah,
uh-huh. That's great. Nice. Yeah. Yeah.
Without having the a bigger camp, it's like more like, I mean, more work and
yeah,
it's a lot of work anyway. So
I know.
Anyway.
It is, yeah. Are you going to go this year?
I'm not going to go this year, unfortunately, because I have I'm planning to stay 1 month in Europe that time. So
that's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. I know you have to.
Next year.
I'm kind of like that too. Like 1 year on, 1 year off. Yeah. You know, because it's a lot. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot. I mean, it's great. I was already preparing to. Anyway.
Yeah.
Anyway, this is not the.
This is not the Burning Man show.
Too much time on Burning Man. Okay. No, it's a great thing. It's Your music, no?
Yeah.
We were talking about your ethno dub, so influence from all over the world.
Yeah.
Yeah. Your passion. You brought an oud right here, no? So you're gonna play some.
A little bit, yeah.
A little bit.
Yeah.
Just you're gonna do like an impro, just oud.
I'll play some traditional pieces, you know.
Okay. Yeah.
Classical pieces. Yeah. Yeah. So I mean, the short little story is my father was an airline pilot.
Okay.
Out of Los Angeles, and we traveled around all the time when I was a kid, like a little kid, and I just became really just in love, you know, like with traveling from like age 10. You know?
Okay.
And then being in Los Angeles, also a great city, you know, growing up in LA, experiencing lots of different cultural enclaves, different cultural festivals, different cultural traditions, like overlapping again, the same thing. And then just getting really into, I think I kind of, there was certain musical artists, and I brought some in my playlist, you know, like Peter Gabriel, Brian Eno, you know, the David Byrne compilations, you know, with Brian Eno and collaborations and stuff like that. And then Jamaican dub music and just that whole thing that was kind of happening, like kind of in, well, it was actually in this mid 70s, but I was starting to get into it like the mid to late 80s and 90s, where it was more of like that kind of sound, you know, Peter Gabriel's Real World Records and all of that ethnographic music coming in. I just was completely into it. And then I discovered that music can have a kind of a spiritual component. And then I got really, really into that aspect. And I kind of, for a minute, like stopped just listening to pop music and like modern music and was studying the oud and kind of was getting deeper into Sufism and working with Turkish musicians, Moroccan musicians, and just trying to learn the traditions, you know. And I took a degree in anthropology and was getting really deep into the musical aspect of culture for a long time. And then I kind of came back and sort of returned, you know, to like the modern world and started becoming a DJ and Burning Man guy and stuff like that. But I have a period in my life where I was really focused just on traditional
and folk music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got to spend time like with Hamza El Din. He's a famous Nubian oud player. He was friends with Mickey Hart and those guys, you know, and had a lot of Turkish teachers and was really seeking that spiritual experience in the music. And so I hope that I can bring a little bit of that tradition into my more modern stuff.
Music, yeah.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
I mean, definitely you bring it because it's part became part of you, no?
Mm-hmm.
And actually gave you kind of your like foundation.
And even I think, you know, if I ever stop doing electronic music, which I doubt, but I can always return back. You know, my wife is Turkish and, you know, I have family now in Istanbul and various parts of Turkey. And so I, you know, I've kind of landed firmly in that place.
In the red, I think I've read somewhere like you married your style, no? Your music style.
Someone said that. Yeah, and we met actually at the temple at Burning Man.
It's
perfect.
Yeah, it's like the circle is closing.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah. So I feel like I was talking with a musician in Cuba once for the World of Sound thing, and we just were talking about, and when you have a tradition, you know, it can really carry you far in your life if you have something, if you're not just following like a trend, you know.
Yeah, because it's kind of a path that you pursue, no? And mm-hmm. then you see that probably there is a destination and you want to reach it, but you know that there is a way to get there, mm-hmm. no? So you embark on
exactly
that, no?
Exactly, that's right.
Embark on that route.
Yeah
Cool. So actually, you know, now we mentioned, you mentioned World of Sound. Uh-huh. There is it's a series of traveling and music videos. Mm-hmm. No? I think I've seen it on YouTube. There are a few episodes. You've been mm-hmm. to Cuba recently. There are some in Turkey. Uh-huh. And in the Red Forest with this percussionist. Uh-huh. So. Yeah. You go to places and you interview local musician, mm-hmm. and you get a. There is one in New Orleans, the mm-hmm. Music Box Village.
Yeah, you saw a lot of them, huh?
Yeah. I mean, I didn't know about it. It was like a revelation. I couldn't stop. You know, when you started watching one episode of one series and then you see the whole series.
That's a good compliment. I mean, you were into it. Yeah.
I mean, I love music. So and I love like traveling as well. So I wasn't that fortunate to grow up on an airplane like you. No?
But the World of Sound project. So you know, I just kind of felt like I wanted to do a little more. You know, like I wanted to do not just releasing tracks, but I wanted to almost like kind of give back. You know, like to highlight other people. Like some people start a record label, like folks like yourself, like you do a radio show. The video thing was kind of my, like, you know, like I just wanted, that's what I wanted to do. So I was hitting it really hard a couple years ago and traveling a lot and filming everywhere and doing all this stuff, and I've slowed down a little bit just to kind of like regroup a little bit, and I'm finishing up some episodes now that are going to come out in the summer. But I love the project so much. So it's basically a travel show about music. So we go to different cities, we interview all the musicians that we can meet there. And the goal is really to get it up onto Netflix or Hulu or something and turn it into like a show, because I would really love to have that be the next layer of my career, is to be more of a cultural kind of like ambassador or something like that, you know? So right now it's just totally independent. Like I'm just filming and producing everything myself, editing and doing all the stuff. And video is a lot of work, man.
Yeah, I was about to ask you, like, it's gonna take a lot of time.
Because
you film it and then you edit,
and promoting, and
then you make the music also.
Yeah, I know. I took a little break last year because I hadn't done any music in a couple of years, and I was like, I need to get back to going and doing some tunes, you know. So I went ahead and put out the little EP I did last year, and then the one that just came out last week. And, you know, I'm looking for funding. I'm looking for, you know, some grants or some angle to kind of, like, keep the World of Sound thing going.
Yeah, if you're listening to this, you know, you want to contribute, worldisound.tv.
TV,
you know? And there is contact information.
And all the stuff's on my website, too, you know, the jefstott.com site.
You have some more episodes in the making, no?
A couple more from Cuba and a couple more from New Orleans, late last year, like a year ago, I spent a lot of time with the Mardi Gras Indians. So the like the wild Chapatulas and those kind of folks from New Orleans that have the whole kind of masking tradition that's part of Mardi Gras. So you see them like with a lot of feathers, and they're like kind of dressed sort of like Native Americans, but it's kind of an Africanized version of Native American. It's the very hybrid kind of like cultural expression.
Fusion style.
I got to sit down with a couple of the leaders of those organizations and do some interviews, and they're really powerful because they talk about, you know, the history of the tradition, which has some pretty rough patches. You know, there's like, you know, the slave trade and you know, serious like oppression and just the way that their culture kind of managed to navigate through those difficult times and stay vital.
You know, this is it's kind of, it's interesting in a in a few ways, no? Because there is the historical part, mm-hmm. because you get to know, the context mm-hmm. that was around, no? Mm-hmm. So, like the slave trade, mm-hmm. like there was a lot of blood shed in this country, you know, civil war, like slavery, segregation, you know.
It's still going.
It's still going. Yeah. Like, less, fortunately, but it's still going. There is a lot of violence, mm-hmm. gun violence.
Yeah.
And another way is it's good to connect also in the music point mm-hmm. of view, because you get to know the root. I mean, so the what brought and made this sound. Yeah. That is, you know, like the elements that came from different parts, no, yeah. and then put together yeah. that sound.
Yeah, especially in Cuba, man. Cuban music is. I mean, this. I'm going to be just like an idiot and say this so simply, but it's just completely off the chain, beautiful and complex. Like, especially the rhythmic stuff, like the bata, you know, yeah. the kind of Afro-Cuban rhythms. Like, they're just so complicated and so beautiful, and it's so intertwined and interlocking, and it's just incredible, you know. And then these bands, you know, these musicians that you see in Cuba are just like incredible, like, you know. And they're just hanging out. They're like, just, oh yeah, we're doing a gig. And they're just like insane.
And yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, the hybrid, you know, the Caribbean, all that stuff. I mean, all these places have a kind of a dark kind of like element of the history, but then the cultures are so beautiful and so vibrant and almost like celebrating, dancing on top of the difficult times, you know?
But you know, like, it's true, like you say, that there's a dark element in the background, but music was the element actually that breakthrough, the mm-hmm. overcome, no?
Yeah.
So it was the revolution through music, was
right.
mostly through music.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
blues was because the only way to, it was lament yeah. in the cornfield.
No? Yeah, and hip hop, you know, I mean, all this stuff. I mean, these are all like protest music, you know. It's like, and it's like identifying yourself culturally through sound, you know. And
also a way to, like, in a cathartic way, to like demonize, you know, like seeing the evil to be mm-hmm. better, no? Like mm-hmm. seeing your pain to,
right.
to feel better, you know.
Right.
Something.
Yeah. Like get, yeah. externalize it, like get it out. Yeah.
So that's why, you know, like, music is very powerful, and without music I cannot even imagine this world going, like, stop
no.
even spinning, you know, like.
Yeah, I know.
And that's why, you know, like, I really appreciate the work you do mm. as a producer, composer, and also, you know, with this like being like a cultural ambassador, mm-hmm. you know, like bringing. Yeah. Bringing like to other people, or sharing to other people, like what you see about, like, you know, being a cultural ambassador. Like,
yeah, I mean, you know, I'm just like a guy, you know, I'm just a dude from LA, but I mean, I want to give something back, you know, I don't want to just take, you know, there's a whole, because, you know, there's been a lot of conversation, you know, the past couple of years, and rightfully so, about cultural appropriation and, you know, traditions and, you know, the whole idea of sampling or like fusion or hybrids or whatever. And you know, my response to that is, you know, well, yeah, I mean, I spent 10 years learning the oud, and I've traveled, you know, and I've worked with different musicians from around the, you know, because I mean, a lot of folks are just like pulling samples, you know.
Yeah.
So I wanted that was the thing with the world of sound. I wanted to give back. I wanted to highlight other people that yeah. are doing so much amazing stuff, you know, and it's been great. I mean, I've met so many amazing people, you know. It's really nice.
And you're planning to keep going on this? You
yeah.
have some other episode.
Yeah. Do you know DJ Sep? She's a dub,
yeah.
dub mission. So
yeah.
she and I are talking casually, but we're getting closer to confirming some things about going to Jamaica together.
Okay, cool.
Which would be great. And then I really want to go to Morocco.
Okay.
Because I love the Gnawa music from Marrakesh, like the Sufi trance music
yeah.
from Marrakesh. And there's so many beautiful traditions within Morocco that would be amazing.
Yeah, with the Sahara Desert.
Yeah, and the, you know, Atlas Mountains and Djoudjouka and, you know, all those guys, you know. So there's so many, I mean, everywhere. I'd love to go to Bahia, you know, Brazil, and, you know, I'd love to go to Berlin, you know, and check out that scene, Bali, you know, there's so many places
yeah.
that are just, you know.
Just, you know, it's the world is your palette. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
you know, and, you know, so I'm looking for people that have connections in different cities that want to invite me, and because it takes a team, you know, you can't
oh, yeah.
just yeah, you can't just do it by yourself. You need people to hook you up and connect you with the musicians and stuff.
And you know, you do, I guess it's not like right now, at this moment in time, it's not a big production. So if
no.
you, yeah, just you do it yourself. So
yeah. Cuba,
with assistance.
Sorry. Yeah, Cuba was the first time that I actually had like a team because the guys in Cuba really wanted to partner with me. So usually it was me and my wife just filming everything. And then in Cuba, we had a couple guys that.
When it's you on the frame, yeah, it's your
that's
wife.
Her. Yeah, okay. Pretty much. Yeah.
I mean, that's a good way also, traveling, you know, like you're getting a nice experience out of it.
The only thing is it's kind of tiring and not really a vacation. So, you know, it's like a different mindset.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, because you have a point, you have something to do, you know? Mm-hmm. And you're going to just, okay, let's hang out and chill. You know?
Yeah,
and
like enjoy. When we were in Istanbul, not last year, but like a year and a half ago, and we did something like, I don't know, like 10 episodes in like 5 days, you know, filming, like just filming. And, you know, and then for each episode, each 10 or 15 minute episode, you film like 2 or 3 hours of material, and then you have...
pre-produce, and then you do the post-production.
Uh-huh.
Then.
Yeah, voiceover and editing, and, you know, licensing the music and all the stuff, you know.
But, you know, probably this is coming from, like, a need of storytelling that you have, no? And, and you do this in music, and then this is another media to tell a story. And
because it's like, you know, I have that interest in anthropology, you know, and filmmaking and documentary filmmaking is definitely part of the you know, the tradition of anthropologic discipline, you know. So I felt like that's a way that I can contribute to preserving the cultures, you know.
Yeah, but also because... sometimes, you know, if you try to tell a story in the form of a track, it's not that easy because music sometimes need attention and you need focus. If you want to just like see the nuances, see the what's in between the lines of a track, you need time. And these days are like instant gratification days.
I know.
So, you know, the attention span is like few seconds.
Mm-hmm.
So probably, you know, the music by just itself is not that doesn't reach the point as you used to.
Yeah.
So probably in a different medium, like video, where you combine different like elements, the music is a part of it.
Yeah.
The visual aspect is all a part of it. No?
Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting. Yeah. It's just, well, and the thing also is because of streaming. I have very strong feelings about streaming of media, of music. So music's everywhere, right? Like it's easy, like it's, you know, but something like, you know, I'm a big fan of Game of Thrones. I'm very excited right now about the show and everything. And it's that whole narrative, like I'm going to sit and watch this whole thing, like for 2 hours or whatever, and I'm going to pay attention, you know?
Yeah.
You don't get that as much with music because it's just on everyone's, you know, like a... you know, playlist of iPods, you know, always in the background sort of thing. Yeah. So that's why I agree. I think that visual media narrative storytelling is like kind of, you have to kind of, as an artist, I think you have to evolve a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, it's, as a storyteller, probably if you want to be a storyteller, probably you need to evolve, you know, and add a different layer to extra layer. No.
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess.
Yeah, and as you know, as you know, and also like I got into education. You know, I teach music production, and it's, you know, as you get older, you know, like I've been doing this a long time, and you know, I have some experiences that I want to share. Like, you know, like, so I think, you know, it's the reason like athletes become a coach, or like you know writers become professors or whatever. It's like that sort of thing where you want to give back. You want to, you know, seed the next generation so they have some knowledge.
How was your music training, music education? You just self-taught?
Yeah, mostly self-taught. I don't actually have a degree in music. I've been playing music since I was like a kid. Like, you know, it's like a...
You say you start with guitar.
Yeah, like that was a LA kind of hard rock, like skateboard kind of punk rock kid, you know. Yeah, it's cool, you know.
It's normal.
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah. It's a little skater punk. And then the dub music and reggae kind of was the beginning of kind of the interest, you know, and of the world music stuff. I've been releasing music for like most of my life, you know, and I've been in bands, and I was one of those kids that I was a pretty good guitar player when I was a kid, and so I was actually playing in clubs before I was 21, before I was 18. I was in a band, and they'd have to, like, you know, my mom would drop me off or whatever at the club and pick me up and stuff, you know.
They started that in Europe, like, we laugh about it, no? Like, because at 21, you are already, like, good for retirement.
Yeah.
You know,
like, yeah. Anyway. So, yeah, so it's been just, you know, ongoing. But then, you know, with the Middle Eastern oud and stuff, that was a pretty serious, like, I had a teacher.
Was
serious about that. And also with the percussion.
Okay.
The Middle East percussion, I had teachers and things. And then, you know, I've spent times, you know, learning production, like with, you know, mastering engineers and other, like, technically oriented people to learn. Because you working the equipment in the studio is kind of like science, you know.
Yeah.
You know, so I wanted to learn, you know, that. I think that's why my mixes are sounding better and better, because I'm actually really learning the science of mixing, you know. Because, you know, I don't like it when I put something on, I'm like, oh, I wish the bass was quieter or whatever, you know, so you have to kind of like learn that stuff, you know.
And also, you know, this is something that with experience, you get more confident with your own sound.
Yeah. I've noticed my music is actually getting simpler, less complicated, you know.
Yeah, but probably like it's a process, no, that mm-hmm. brought you to mm-hmm. that point, no?
Mm-hmm. And yeah. Like just getting more of elemental, you know, like the essence, like, of the music. Yeah.
Yeah, but still, it's, talking about the last thing, actually, it's the only track that we play, like,
today. We're talking a lot.
I mean, there's so many things to do, actually. I was worried that probably in 2 hours we cannot fit, like, all the topics that we could cover in this conversation here. But, you know, like, that song that we've been listening to, Osiris, mm-hmm. the title track of the EP. So it's multi-layered, and mm-hmm. There are different elements and of like tradition and innovation, mm-hmm. not to put in a...
Yeah.
So let's talk about this EP that just came out like Saturday.
It came out last Friday.
Last Friday,
26th or whatever. Yeah, and it came out through... I'm partnering with Six Degrees, so they did all the distribution, so it's out everywhere, like on all the channels. You know, it's available just under my name, Jef Stott. And the real... motivation for the EP was I was actually asked to collaborate with Jill Parker and her tribal belly dance troupe called Little Egypt, and they asked me to write a piece for them.
Okay.
And so that was this other piece, Quiet Royalty, the one that's the Requiem for
San Francisco Underground.
That's right. So that was a commission actually for a belly dance company, and they premiered it in Las Vegas at a big conference. And then I just was in the groove with that tune, and then the other tune kind of came out like right next to it, you know. And I just said, because usually, you know, I may only release the two songs. It's like a single, basically.
Yeah.
And usually I like to release at least five tunes together, but I just thought, these are happening. I'm just going to pop them out really quick. So I finished them just like a month ago, and they just came out.
Fresh off the...
Yeah, super fresh. Yeah. And they came pretty quick, you know. You know, it was interesting. Jill approached me. She said, hey, we need this thing and we need it fast. We need it like in a week. And I was like, oh my God, you know, like that's fast. And I said, I'll try. And then I sat down and within 2 days, their Quiet Royalty piece was like basically done. And I was like, I was even surprised. Like, whoa, that was fast. And then I just kept that energy kind of flowing and finished
it. Another truck mm-hmm. came out.
Yeah. So they're both, you know, they're a little, they're a little heavy, especially for the summertime. But, you know, I mean, emotionally, you know, they're kind of like serious pieces.
Yeah.
But whatever, it's okay.
I mean, Osiris, the god of afterlife.
Right.
With a name like this, should be something like that.
Well, like, you know, last summer I put out the Aslan Dub System.
And that's Volume 1.
Volume 1. I'm still working on Volume 2. Don't worry, it's coming. And that's more of a beach kind of vibe, you know, it's got the... reggae,
the Balkan beach,
Balkan beach, you know, there's like, you know, and I think my fans were kind of like, well, this is kind of different, you know, because it's a little bit more like, it's fun, it's not totally serious, you know, because I really love dub music, and I love, you know, like cumbia and, you know, electro cumbia and, like, you know, this kind of more tropical kind of sounds, you know. So I wanted to kind of, you know, I wanted to put some of that out. So that was last summer.
Yeah, my, you know, like, it's also music is a manifestation of your emotion. Mm-hmm. So if you feel like more light and you want to release some music that is more like beach vibe, no?
And I love the beach, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I grew up surfing we spent a lot of time on the Aegean coast, you know, with my wife and her family, and you know, I love that, just the beach vibe, you know.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah, but also, you know, it's you have a variety of music, no?
Yeah.
Feelings as well. So
yeah.
You have the moment more intense, the moment more light.
Uh-huh.
It's part of it, no.
Yeah, I mean, but I also kind of feel like, you know, the audience, they want a brand, you know, like if you go off the brand, if you go off, you know, change your style, people are like, oh, what happened, you know?
I mean, it's not drastically change, you know?
No.
Your elements are there. Probably, it's not like you're doing a punk song.
Yeah, country western.
Country western.
Although I heard Diplo's doing country now. That's what I heard.
I mean, you can do. I mean, probably you have like moniker, different moniker for different sounds.
You know, I kind of wish that I did, and because I come from like a rock music background, like, you know, I didn't pick like, okay, you know, Jef's, you know, ethno dub is going to be called, you know, Osiris or whatever, and his dub is going to be Aslan or whatever. I should have maybe like picked that, like to have each different moniker, but I put everything out just under my name.
Yeah.
So maybe, I don't know. I never know if that was a good idea or not. It's hard to say.
Yeah. It's, I actually had the same thing, but I'm not, it's just my idea.
Yeah.
It's, if you, it's a matter of your personality, you know, if you're multi-personal inside of you,
mm-hmm.
you can do that easily, you know?
Mm-hmm.
If you stick with an identity and try to, you know, it get more complicated.
Yeah. 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 I don't know.
Anyway.
I'm too far in now. I mean, like, I'm 20 years in. It's like, I'm not going to change.
Yeah, point of no return is already
passed.
Yeah, it's okay. It's so good. It's so good. But let's talk about your producing process, no?
I'm sorry, what?
How you make music,
uh-huh.
how do you produce the music, no?
Yeah.
So in that case, with Jill Parker and Little
mm-hmm.
Egypt, you were commissioned, no?
Mm-hmm.
So you had actually like a strict deadline, and probably that gave you like, you know, a limitation you
mm-hmm.
can find. Like, so how do you sit down and you start playing like a melody with, you have a collection of instruments.
I do, I mean, like Osiris was definitely, I work in Ableton Live. That's my software that I work in. And so I had my MIDIs all set up, and I had a lot of the different tabla kind of pads going, and I was tapping out beats and just kind of working. So that tune definitely came from the rhythm.
Okay.
Was the kind of the origin of that. Jill Parker's thing was, they had specific counting and sort of modes that they needed to hit, and they wanted it to be kind of somber, almost like gothic, but they also wanted an Arab, like a rhythmic kind of idea. So I played the darbuka and put in that stuff on top of the string section that I was working with.
Okay.
So so sometimes it does come from the traditional, like the, you know, if I get a chance to play a little bit, I'll play some of the traditional pieces that were the foundation, you know, of the electronic sound. Other pieces are just based on rhythms, and they're more like, you know, impressionistic, you know, like just rhythm sort of stuff. I also really like ambient music quite a lot, ambient electronic music. So sometimes, you know, I'll just be laying out these atmospheres, you know, and then I'll have just like some gentle kind of thing like coming in. I think it's really just, it's about a feeling, you know.
And you pursue the feeling.
And I have to say, unfortunately, I don't have a quote unquote like recording studio right now. I'm working like just basically in an office. I have all my stuff with me and everything set up. But before, I had a studio in Hayes Valley, and I had all my instruments out. They were all plugged in, like ready to go. And it was a lot more acoustic oriented jamming going on.
Yeah.
And now it's more like sample based, or I'll play something really quick and I'll play my instrument and then I'll cut it up and make it more like sample oriented and things like that. So in a way, I think that is affecting the style of music that I'm producing, because it's more electronic, because that's the easiest thing for me to do at this time based on on my space that I create in.
Yeah.
Right. So if I had a, if I had a big, even a place like we're in right now, then I would probably have more like live drums and more jamming and, you know, people coming over and jamming and stuff like that. But now it's more solo, kind of like electronic.
The space actually is
affecting. Yeah. And I'm not sure that I like it. I'd like to have more, I'd like to have more instruments, more, you know, jam sessions and things like that. So I'd like to kind of cultivate that and bring that back in. Yeah.
But for now it works.
And now it's great. Yeah. I mean, I can get stuff done quickly, you know, it's fast. And I also feel like I'm not, I know what I want to say as an artist. Like I'm not like searching for identity. Yeah. Like I'm like, okay, boom. Like I can finish the song like in a day, you know?
Yeah. You know what they say? And that's, you know, that's why the Island Up system was volume one, because you're already planning the volume two.
Yeah.
So your part is.
Yeah, yeah. So Sep and I are going to work on a track together. I'm also partnering with some other folks on some more cumbia stuff. Okay. And I'm also kind of getting back into like the origins of dubstep, like before it became wah, 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 like super crazy. Like just, but the rhythm of dubstep, that halftime kind of stepper sort of thing, I really love it a lot. And so I'm going to, there's an artist I really like a lot called 100 Drums. She's a female producer up in Nevada City that's doing kind of this like Afro dubstep kind of rhythmic kind of thing that I think is really great. Okay. You know, so I think the word dub means a lot of things, right? It can be dubstep, it can be like
dub music,
dub, you know,
dub edits,
yeah, you know. So I think if when we start working on the Aslan dub system part two, it's not necessarily going to be reggae. Like it can be dub, can mean a lot of different things.
Yeah, actually, I was reading like some interview of you. You were saying that the dub music was actually show the producer the mixer skills, no? Because you can dub out putting effects like sound, some effects, reverb, delay, and transform, no?
Yeah.
There was probably the Jamaicans when they got access to the British technology, no? Mm-hmm. They started fucking messing up with that, you know, and create a genre, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I always say to my students, like, you know, I think, you know, Jamaican dub music is like the origin of remix culture. Like, it's the origin almost of electronic music. I mean, you know, like the, you know, German kind of Kraftwerk and those guys did that kind of style of repetitive like electronic music. But the whole idea of remixing and being like impressionistic or whatever with sound, I think it's from Jamaica.
Yeah.
And so, you know, this little tiny island in the Caribbean like exploded like all music, all modern music.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's huge. I love dub music. Yes.
We do. It's mutual.
Yeah.
I say that. Yeah. So let's listen to the Requiem for
Underground.
Okay, sure. That's if we talk about it.
Yeah.
And then we get ready for you to perform, and then we talk a little bit
more. Okay, sure.
It sounds good as
Whatever you want, man.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's 2:47. You're listening to Espresso Session BFF.fm. Jef Stott is sitting next to me.
Yes.
We're going to play the second, the B-side of the single.
Yeah, Quiet Royalty.
AKA the Requiem for the SF Underground. Jef Stott. We'll be right back. And you just listened to Quiet Royalty, Jef Stott made this piece for Little Egypt belly dance. Where you can see that you were mentioning before, you were commenting before, this, you don't want to listen to this in the daylight. No?
Yeah, it's a little, but it's beautiful. It's very nice. Yeah. And like I said earlier, I'm into the Game of Thrones, and it's got that kind of like epic.
Like a soundtrack. Yeah. Perfect. Yeah. As a ballet.
You know, and I'm thinking too, you know, now that this is done, I'd actually like to get an MC, like maybe a female MC, to do a version, you know,
of that
on top, you know, like have some lyric. I could hear that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Because it's like kind of basically trap, like the rhythms are trap beats, basically, which is popular these days. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
It's 808 the non repeat, putting faster, right? 132, yeah,
exactly, 30 seconds. Yeah. And the cool thing about that kind of music is that it's pretty empty, you know, so you can layer in other things really easily, like it's not like dense music, you know. It's great stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, keep you excited.
I like it.
Yeah, you know, this is a kind of like recall a question, no, about the music and the Bay Area. You've been here. I mean, even though you are from LA, it's like very close.
Yeah, I know. It's not like, you know, from like, you know.
You are not from another planet. You know,
no.
No. But you've been here for like
25
years.
Yeah, so, I came for school.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so you got to see this city evolving.
Yeah, I mean, one of the first things I did upon arriving was to go to Nikki's and, you know, my people, because I was already really into the global thing in LA, right?
Because
I used to work at KCRW and I lived next door to Tom Schnabel and all this stuff. And so people were telling me, oh, well, if you're going to go to San Francisco, you've got to check out this guy, Chebby Sabah. Like, you have to. And so then, boom.
It was this Tuesday night, I wasn't here back then.
Yeah, but it was amazing.
It was, like, epic. No,
You know, and it's a tiny place. I mean, you know, things look bigger in your memory, right?
Yeah.
You know, but it was packed every night. And he was there, I think it was a 20-year run. Like, you know.
Okay.
You know, it was amazing. So then, and then simultaneously, so we had that kind of Chebby's sound, and then, you know, the Bhangra kind of thing, you know, South Asian kind of vibes going on. And then we have, you know, Ali Akbar Khan College up in Marin. So a lot of Indian musicians are here studying. So there's all these great musicians in town, tabla and sarod and sitar and stuff. And then this whole like tribal belly dance thing kind of originated in San Francisco. Or in the Bay Area, and then it really became very popular actually here in the Mission, with the Cafe Istanbul, and then, oh gosh, what was the name of that? Amira's? I think Amira's was the place. Beautiful.
I don't know these places.
And then, as you know, the warehouse scene
was
huge. And, you know, I was at Cell Space, and I shared, you know, David Satori from Beats Antique had this studio next door to mine. And so we have these huge, epic underground parties, you know, Lauren, Bass Nectar would play, and, you know, these yoga tai chi parties back in the day. And like, you know, just, you know, the kind of the Burning Man sound sort of grew out of the Bay Area underground warehouse scene. So you had this kind of like bass music, medium tempo bass music sort of thing, which is what kind of Lauren was doing before he went sort of like, you know, heavy duty with his sound. He was more like medium to down tempo with like bass. So that was great, and that all happened. And then I think also San Francisco was really well known as of just straight up electronic music. Like, it was really up on the tip of like Berlin and London, and then San Francisco had its own kind of like sound. You know, 1015 Folsom has been going forever. And what was that those other places? What was that? I never even went there. You know, there's so many great clubs that have come and gone, but they're huge, amazing places. I'm kind of blanking on some of the names of the clubs from the early days. But it's always been like vital, like really, and concentrated. Like, this is a small place.
Well done, yeah.
You know? I mean, I come from LA, it's like huge, you know? And I always felt like there was no vibe. And San Francisco's all vibe. Like, it's just packed, like, you know? So I think the scene is still really vital. I hope that people, realize how important, you know, nightlife and culture is. I mean, I know a lot of the new folks coming to town, like, they like to eat in fancy restaurants and they like to, you know, do these sort of things, but if they don't support the art, it's going to go away. So, you know, it's really important to, you know, keep it weird. Like, it's important, you know.
Yeah, keep it. It's like you mentioned, support the art, support also the emerging art, because, you know, in this city, it's easy to see sold out shows of big names.
Yeah.
But there are like the emerging artists. Mm-hmm. Nobody cares.
We're in a difficult time, just I think with being a musician in general, just because of the streaming, you know, that there's just, you know, I just saw Feral or whatever got, you know, I don't know, like $1,200 or something for like 50 million streams on Spotify, and it's just not sustainable, you know. We just, it takes time and effort and money to make music, and if you can't make it back, you know, I have a day job. I mean, all of us have jobs, you know. It's like very rare that someone's making pure living just off other music these days. Yeah. So, yes, we need to keep the emerging artist scene thriving. I mean, there's still good spots. Like Red Poppy Art House is amazing. The Cafe Revolution Cafe in the Mission. You know, there's still things going on. And I live in Oakland now, and I think Oakland's really got a great scene. I mean, it's really, there's a lot going on, and people are just doing pop-up kind of stuff and these new bars and, you know, Hello Stranger and the Elbow Room's over there now. And like, you know, it's pretty great stuff, you know.
Are you still doing the Elbow Room?
Yeah, I just got started.
Okay.
Yeah. So June 1st is the next one.
Okay.
And that's a World of Sound party.
Yeah.
Where it's in the downstairs, just like a bar. It's like old school. It's in a bar. It's not a big club, you know, and I just basically spin for like 4 hours.
Okay.
Just, you know, wild, like eclectic, global bass music. You know, ranging all around the world. And, you know, Jill Parker joined us for a little improvisation dance thing in the middle of the bar, which was fun. And, you know, and I'm just trying to just stay active, you know, with just, you know, I don't have like a big agenda with that night. Like, of course, I'd love to be in a big club and have, you know, all my favorite DJs playing and all of that. But I can start small. It's okay.
Yeah.
And just build, you know. So it's June 1st.
June 1st. Okay.
Yeah. Elbow Room in Oakland.
I never been to Elbow Room Oakland, but apparently it looks like the Elbow Room in SF.
Yeah, it's similar.
Two level.
A little smaller, actually, but it's similar. It used to be some kind of weird, like, cowboy bar. It's got this kind of, like, cowboy kind of vibe. I mean, I don't mean cowboy like Texas. I mean, like, Barbary Coast, like Gold Rush kind of vibe, you know.
Right.
It's cool.
Rodeo.
Yeah. Yeah, there's some good stuff going on. You know, and of course, now I should have made a list of all these places. I didn't think of it, but there's a new like multi-room hip-hop spot in Oakland that's kind of, it just popped up on my feed a couple weeks ago. That's like pretty amazing. And then just, there's a lot, you know, there's just a lot going on. And we still have the really big, like, we've got Cal Performances, and we've got these, you know, the Fox and the, you know, the bigger venues in the East Bay. And it just, you know, there's still a lot going on. You know, people say, you know, people that have left San Francisco, oh, it's over. And it's not over. It's, you know.
No, it's not over. Yeah, like we talk about this at the beginning. At the beginning, we were offline.
Yeah,
yeah, it's changing, but there are still so many great stuff, and so many great stuff to discover.
Yeah,
yeah.
And I heard I was hosting. I lead a digital music program at SF Jazz. That's where I work, and we had Michael Romanowski, and he was teaching mastering last weekend, and he was saying, yeah, I mean, he's from Nashville, and we were talking about the difference between Nashville and LA and New York, and then he said, and then San Francisco is the fourth biggest music market in the country. So it's still very vital, you know, and then I guess Atlanta's coming up as the next, like, big spot for music, all that trap music.
So there is LA, New York, New Orleans?
And Nashville.
Nashville and San Francisco.
San Francisco is the fourth biggest, which I was surprised to hear, but he said there's really a lot of like venues, like big venues here. Yeah. But I think the love is in the underground, you know. That's where the juice is. Like, you know, these crazy underground parties that just like, you know, just so many crazy things have happened. They're just wild. You know, like Supper Club. I don't know if you remember Supper Club, but it was so great.
Yeah.
I used to play there all the time.
It's gone. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't want to be the guy that keeps going, it's gone, it's gone.
No, I mean, we just lost. Today is last day of Luca Ravioli also.
I know. Yeah, so many you know, I'm going to make a t-shirt, and it's going to say, it was better before. in big white letters, because that's what everyone says. No, it's all good. It's great.
Yeah, I mean, things are changing. You know, like gentrification is a part of it's a natural thing, no?
Yeah.
Yeah. Just, you know, who works in the arts,
yeah,
you should just keep working harder.
Yeah.
Keep pushing more, you know, like just
There's a new, really nice new spot that Nonstop Bungra is doing stuff out at called Seventh West.
Yeah,
it's in West Oakland. It's a big outdoor like patio kind of place, and it's really got a great vibe. Really good.
Yeah, I heard about it. Never been there. I also in Oakland, the band camp opened a space, and so there are things.
So, but I think the scene here has always been about experimentation, you know, because the politics, you know, like it's a very liberal, progressive city, and people want to experiment, or they want to try things out. It's not LA, like it's even like back in the day, like when Francis Ford Coppola, you know, was here, and the Star Wars, you know, Lucas and the Star Wars team, like they didn't want to be in LA. They wanted to be here because they wanted to be outside of the studio system. They wanted to be experimental, and they wanted to do their own thing. And I think that's still, in some ways, still part of the mix here. People, they want to build their own style and not like just be a commercial musician in LA.
Yeah, but also, you know, there is a beauty in here that is, you know, it's pretty evident, and it's like a trademark of this city. You know?
Yeah.
So being a small town, like with this microclimate and, you know.
Well, yeah. And then that reminds me, I mean, so then the whole West Coast festival scene, right, which is huge, kind of fueled in some ways by, you know, cannabis money. But it really blew up. I mean, I know artists that don't really play in the United States except for on the West Coast in these festivals. You know, we're talking about like Lightning in a Bottle or Enchanted Forest, and then there's Beloved Festival, and you know, all of these, and they're kind of all kind of tangentially related in some ways to Burning Man. Like Burning Man's like the home base, and then these other festivals are popping up, but it's definitely a West Coast kind of Northern California kind of thing.
Bob, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. There is more, it's more mystic. It's more like nature oriented, mm-hmm, and community driven. They're more like the big SoCal festival, like Coachella.
Yeah, it's like the anti Coachella.
Yeah, it's completely different. It's it's another vibe.
Yeah,
and it's it's kind of like the identity of NorCal. No, mm-hmm, it's more like conscious and aware
yoga, healthy lifestyle. Yeah, yeah, multicultural. Yeah, it's good.
Yeah, we. I remember actually last week I had this guest DJ Lamonti. He works at KPO.
Okay, cool.
He has a music DJ studio in the Mission, and I forgot the point. I missed the point.
California consciousness.
Anyway, I forgot this.
Yeah.
No, 0 point, man. It's okay.
Yeah, KPO is cool.
Yeah. No, it was about the. The consciousness,
maybe it's time for music.
Yeah, it's time for music. Anyway. Moment of, the zero, the moment. Yeah. Of, we forgot the link. Yeah.
It's getting hot in here, maybe running out of oxygen and getting sleepy.
Yeah. It's okay, probably. Probably
it's a long show. We can just hang out.
It's a long show, 2 hours.
Yeah.
You know, probably should take a break from talking. Okay. You want to play some?
Should we try the oud? Okay, yeah, let's try it. Yeah. So you can describe what's happening to your people. So we got the oud is a Turkish instrument.
Yes.
Can you hold that in there? Thank you. And we're gonna show it to our people. There you go. That's good. Thank you. So this is the oud, everybody. I don't know if you can see it. Right. Traditional. It originally came from like Babylonian sort of times, you know, like ancient Iraq, and you see folks, you know, around the time of the Egyptian pharaohs and things like that. So the oud is really, really ancient instrument. It probably was the original guitar, and it just, you know, it's still played a lot in the Middle East, but it's, you know, and now it's more like a folkloric instrument, but still like, I don't know. It's just as popular as the violin is here. In that, you know what I mean? It's like you hear oud all the time in the Middle East.
Yeah, it's
It's
an amazing sound, and
It's fretless and has 11 strings. And when I first heard it, I was just like, what is that? I want to play that. Yeah. So I'm gonna kind of move a little bit so I can get a little situated. Maybe can I just lift this up like that?
Yeah, you can lift this up. Great. If you wanna, like, you know,
this is fine. Like, oh no, I can't sit here that long. This is the musical part, so we want to point the mic right here.
Right here.
Yeah. Oh, this is gonna hurt my butt after a while. So there we go.
All right.
So the pick used to be an eagle feather. So now we just use a little piece of like sculpted plastic, but you used to use the feather.
The feather, okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So we're just gonna warm up a little bit. Play what we call toxeme. Asking it like about some of my songs, new productions and stuff, like how do they get started or whatever. So here we go. That's cool. I'll just move it around. Whoa, when I play, this thing's going crazy. So this one's this tune's called Sono, and I learned it from a singer that I've worked with over the years, Irina Mikhailova, and she was singing this with her choir called Kika. And it's a traditional Macedonian tune. Okay. And so then I've just learned how to play it on the oud. Yeah. So you want to get set up here? That'd be good. That's fine. All right. So I'll just play a few bars. I'm not gonna play the whole tune.
All right.
Yeah. You good? Okay.
Great.
Yeah. So that's the oud, you know. Should we bust out another one?
Oh, please, man.
Okay, cool.
I was thinking, like, what you say before, no? At the beginning of your career, when you start playing, like, the Middle Eastern instrument, you were going on like in a spiritual way, because, you know, by itself, this is when you can listen for hours.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And just, yeah, that's the nice thing about finding a tradition that you resonate with, that you can just kind of take with you for the rest of your life. And music is such a great way to explore the world. It's like so great, you know? So yeah, I found some great teachers here in the Bay Area and spent a lot of time, and, you know, I'm not actively like with a teacher right now, but I play, you know, all the time at home. Yeah, it's great. So let's play some more, huh?
Please, okay. Yes.
All right, so this is an Armenian tune.
All right.
Famous tune here. It's in a 10-beat rhythm, by the way, called Jurjuna.
Okay.
And my wife has told me that the rhythm means people going crazy, like chaos. Like,
so cool,
it's,
yeah.
It's a crazy rhythm.
Nice. Okay. The dude with the oud.
I am the dude with the oud.
Yeah.
Yes.
So there was chaos.
Yeah, the chaos. Jurjuna.
Jurjuna
rhythms, yeah. 10-8.
So I was... So the pick is the traditional pick, that long,
yeah,
no?
Pretty much. I mean, it's long. The modern version of the
modern
tradition.
Version, but it's, yeah, it's a long one. So yeah.
It's really nice because you can squeeze it and make it depending on the sound.
Okay.
Like a guitar pick is really tiny.
Yeah,
you
and
know?
It's thicker also. Right?
Yeah, thicker, and the whole squeezing thing is really helpful. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the first string is just...
Solo, one...
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. It's the only one that is the other one are paired. Huh?
Right. And they keep the, sometimes they tune the low string really low, and I think that's why they have just one string, because if it was two, it would vibrate against itself and make a buzzing sound.
Yeah.
So this one's just one by itself. Yeah.
And give the bass like
Yeah, it's super bassy instrument. That's really nice.
That's great, yeah.
Yeah. What do you think? One more?
One more, please.
Okay,
yeah,
great.
Yeah.
I'm going to play like a really relaxing kind of dreamy kind of piece. Okay.
Please. Yeah.
And this is in the mode or the maqam, they say, of Hijaz. And then the rhythm is Shifteteli. And it's a classic Turkish, like very popular tune.
Okay. Jef Stott live here on Oud.
How's that thing doing?
Yeah, I can hold this.
Okay.
Yeah.
You okay? I can make it stay. Let's see. There you go. Something like that. How's that? Good? That's fine.
I can hold this.
Okay.
Right, yeah.
I'll make it fast. Here we go.
Oh. That was beautiful.
Thank you.
That's nice.
You got that? Yeah.
Yeah. Great.
That is the oud.
That is the oud. Yeah.
I'm the dude with the oud.
Nice. Very introspective moment. Took me somewhere else when I was.
Yeah, outside of your normal.
Yeah.
Zone for a minute there.
Yeah.
And yeah, and that's what I discovered that music can do.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, that's also, you know, like talking about the spirituality, mm-hmm. spiritual part in the music,
yeah.
and yeah, the power of music.
Yeah. Yeah, even just playing it, I'm kind of like, kind of coming back into like, oh, I have to talk and I have to.
Oh, yeah. Coming back to the real world, right, after, yeah, some elevated moment. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and we're so lucky. There's a really strong Middle Eastern music community here in the Bay Area, especially in the East Bay. There's like a lot of really amazingly talented people from the Middle East and also students, you know, from California and stuff. And there's a really vibrant scene. Yeah,
going on.
It's really cool.
Yeah, well, for this, you know, like thanks, you know, California for being like open to to culture. Yeah. You know.
Yeah, and people are, you know, keeping it alive. Like, you know, folks are, you know, like American California people are playing music that's, you know, not even that popular in the home country. You know what I mean? Like they're like, they're keeping the tradition going in a way, you know, in their own kind of fusion style.
It is kind of like a little debate, no? About like cultural appropriation or like, you know, embracing aspects from different cultures that are not yours, but you like and you resonate with. Yeah. I think there is... So we are like, well, this is just my opinion. You know? We are like world citizens, so it doesn't matter where you're born, where you're coming from. Well, and you can embrace part of this world culture that they are not close to you geographically, but probably they are like, you know, spiritually or like internally. You know?
I agree totally. And I think it's important for the original forms to keep their integrity, to keep their shape, you know, because if everyone's just borrowing and borrowing and borrowing and borrowing and borrowing, then it turns into just like a big traffic jam. Like it's just a big, whoosh, like, you know, so I think it's, I think, I mean, even though I get in arguments with people online or people say, oh, you're appropriating or whatever, I actually have a lot of respect for the people that say, please don't remix my music or please don't, you know, play the oud if you don't know, you know, if you're not Turkish or whatever. I don't want to hear that from them, and I disagree, like, but I still, I respect that they have that opinion because that their culture is their like, their integrity. It's their life. It's their orientation to the world. And I would in no way ever want to like diminish it or like make any kind of lightness out of it. You know what I mean? So it's a very complicated conversation.
Yeah, but it's, if you're playing the oud, it's like, not just people from Cremona, they are allowed to play violin, you know, because they are from there.
Yeah.
So, you know, it doesn't matter if you don't have to be Italian if you want to sing like opera, you know, even if the most of the plays are in Italian, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm not telling you that you should dress like Pavarotti and pretend to be Pavarotti, you know. Or
Well, so that's the reason. Okay, there's the answer right there to an earlier question. Why don't I have a DJ name, you know, like DJ Swami or DJ Oud or whatever? Because I just wanted to be the dude with the oud. You know, I just wanted to be a guy who loves this music, but I'm still me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm not pretending. I never, ever wear like fake costumes on stage. I don't ever, you know what I mean? Like a caftan or like you know, I'm just a guy that happens to love this instrument very much, you know?
And I think we are talking about the same thing. So if you, so you are exposed to something that is from outside your culture, no? And you love it. So there is no like, I mean, I love cumbia, no?
Yeah.
I love hip hop. When I was in Italy, I was hating, like I had no idea about the Latin music for me was Enrique Iglesias and stuff.
Yeah.
It comes, you know, pop that stuff, no?
Yeah.
And hip-hop back in Italy, I had no idea about the social meaning and the neighborhood life and the lyrics also, no? And so, you know, like, I'm not like dressed like, I mean, I keep my identity, you know, like, and I'm embracing new elements. So mm-hmm. they probably like embracing is something. Cultural appropriation mm-hmm. is when like you bring that to the like, you know.
Yeah, I mean, basically, the you know, to me, the glaring like obvious you know example is like you know the Coachella girl wearing the like Native American headdress.
Oh yeah.
I mean, that's like, that's just, that's it. I mean, that's the easiest thing to point to.
Yeah.
She has no knowledge of the culture. She's wearing it as a fashion. She bought it online and she's going to throw it away after the festival. And it's just, it's wrong on like so many levels.
Yeah.
But I can't, I'm not trying to convince her not to do it. You know what I mean? It's like, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah. But this is not the case of you like playing the wood mm-hmm. and studying it, yeah. like researching on it, mm-hmm. to see the places, mm-hmm. Performers. Mm-hmm. So, and I mean, you are probably would be pretentious for you to say, I'm the wood guy, you know, like, but you say, like, I'm like a little humble, like, student of wood.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, like, I'm not pretend, I'm not Turkish. I mean, even if you married a Turkish woman, and probably you spend a long time there back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, it's still on a path, and it's not this mm-hmm. is not at all cultural appropriation.
Yeah,
this is expanding.
But I've had people call me out, like say, "No, dude, you're not, you know, stay in your lane. Like you don't have, you know." And we've had these long conversations.
Yeah, I mean, this can be like a long which is your lane? Like, not your right? or mine. Which mine lane? Yeah. I mean, I'm from Sicily. Right. I should play like tarantella. You know,
right?
Like,
exactly.
What is? Right? I mean, I love tarantella as well. Sure. But not just that. You know.
Yeah, yeah. I hear you. No, I think it's good. But I, on the other hand, you know, my opening thing where I'm like, yeah, but I respect the people that are holding on to tradition, because if everything just kind of turns into like one mass kind of like culture, you know what I mean? It might lose some of its vitality, you know? Cause I love how like with slow food movement, right? Or like, you know, microbrew or like regional cheeses, or like, those are very specific to the region in which they're produced and they have a local flavor. And I think that local flavor is what is so great about every place in the world, you know? Like, that's one of the reasons why I wanted to leave LA, because it had no local flavor. And now they're really working on bringing like an LA kind of vibe. But I love the Bay Area because of the, you know, Alice Waters and the slow food movement, and you can buy organic food like right from the grower. And there's all these different places, you know, in Sonoma and Napa and stuff like that. They're very regional. And I think that's great. And it's the same thing with music. I think it's really important that people have their own regional style. But then when you get to the cities, then those things start to interact and they start to mix, you know? So I think both are very important.
Yeah. You can also use travel to mm-hmm. go and see the, you know, the regional. It's true. I feel you. Like, I mean, even if like almonds, for example, no?
Yeah.
My wife brought some almonds the other day, and I, without seeing the packages, I tried it. Oh, this tastes like almonds in Sicily, no? And they are from Spain, mm-hmm. and they are more like, you know, you can taste the shell also a little bit, you know, mm-hmm. more kind of like. And, you know, California almonds are great, but they taste different. So mm-hmm. you see that, and probably you need, and you keep that as a very important principle. If you want to experience the authenticity of things, just go to the place, travel,
right.
Get exposed to, and you know, support also local community. Just mm-hmm. being a tourist there,
mm-hmm.
definitely, you know, the cities. That's what the cities does. You know, mm-hmm. they kind of like mash it up, mix mm-hmm. it up. You know, mm-hmm. the elements. Mm-hmm. You know, and make mm-hmm. the metropolitan area. Mm-hmm. You know, there is that.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many beautiful things in food that are like fusion, like, you know, the banh mi sandwich, you know? It's like Vietnamese ingredients
and French.
Or there's the Korean taco, like Korean barbecue and taco together, you know, these things, and they're really good.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. Yeah, I'm also, you know, like, make sense in what you do with the world of sound, mm-hmm. because that's exactly what you're doing. You're going to places to mm-hmm. check, to see the flavors, the authenticity, you know?
That's right.
Yeah, I agree with you. I love fusion, man. I love to live mm-hmm. in a city where my neighbor is Chinese, the other neighbor, and it's from another place. And when I walk down the street, I listen to over here a conversation I don't even know what language
it
is.
Arabic or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sure.
So, you know, I love like being a multicultural.
Mm-hmm. And then that higher vibration of all the different people together turns into the flavor of San Francisco, right? And then we're talking about gentrification, and then, you know, then there's that larger conversation, you know. So, yeah. But I think each place still has its own vibe. You know, even in America, I mean, it's such a big place. Like, you go to different cities, you know, Atlanta or New Orleans, you know, Florida, Miami. They still have a local flavor, you know, which is good.
It's good, yeah. I mean, there is a lot of globalization, but there is still some local flavor. And, you know, I'm aiming to that.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's all good. I think people are waking up to how important their individual voices, you know, like that we need, you know, don't be quiet, like be loud, like make your sound, you know, heard, you know, do your thing. Yeah. Because if you don't, then the corporate machine is going to just totally take over.
Yeah, I know. I'm kind of sorry to hear that somebody like point the finger to you, like you are appropriating. You know, like
it happens. Because you know, I'm active on social media, and I share. Like, well, I'm not going to name any names, but I shared something about a DJ in Europe who put the call to prayer in his DJ set, the mezzanine, you know, the azan.
Oh yeah,
and then I didn't even comment. I didn't say it was a good idea. I just said, you know, what do we think about religious music inside electronic, you know? And it turned into this like week long like thing, and all of my producer people and other people, you know, activists and anthropologists, and everybody got involved in this thing, and it got a little ugly, you know, it got a little crazy. And it's happened a couple times, you know, that people online, you know, they get into like stuff. Yeah. I don't know. It's the era of like the, you know, Trump or something, you know, that everyone's mad.
Everybody's gonna just use the social media just for ranting and
I try to keep it now. I want to, you know, keep it peaceful, you know. I'm a pretty peaceful guy, you know.
Yeah, you know, I think this is one of the good things of living among the many bad things, but one of the good things, if you can use it like living in this era we are mm-hmm. right now.
Yeah.
There is a lot of technology. There can be information overload for sure.
Uh-huh.
Streaming, music streaming service are, they can overload you.
Yeah.
But remember the days when I grew up, I'm 40 years old. Mm-hmm. And I used to go in a small town, Sicily, where I grew up. I used to go to the one record store
mm-hmm.
and wait. I go there every week and see where the new arrivals. Mm-hmm. No? So that was the only outlet for me to get new music.
Yeah.
And you know, I was like a sucker. Oh, this is all I was really waiting for, like the new release. Now you know you can listen to Iranian radio. You can listen to. Music from Bangladesh. You can latest hits from Bali. You know anything?
There's an app on somewhere where you can. There's a globe map, and you just can mouse over, and it just plays the whatever radio is right on that where your mouse is.
Oh, yeah,
it's crazy. It's like so easy.
Yeah,
yeah.
So you know, actually, you know, I think this is something that is amazing. No, like for my where I'm coming from, like it's amazing. No, mm-hmm. you know, people like taking for mm-hmm. granted this
mm-hmm.
stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, you know, there can be like endless discussion, no, about, but, you know, just take like from culture, from the time, from the culture you're exposed to, from the time you're living,
mm-hmm.
just figure out your way and get like, you know, like get and give back like what you like, feel like resonate with. No?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think just, you know, like I'm kind of you may have noticed, like I'm kind of a doer. Like I like to get involved in things. Like I like to participate, which is why I like Burning Man. I like these things where, you know, like I'd like to produce festivals, or I like to, you know, produce my own music. I like to do things. And the same thing like with cooking, you know, I like to be in the kitchen doing stuff, you know. And I just encourage people, if they like something, you know, get a little bit more involved. Like, take a class, like, you know, try a new recipe, like, you know, don't just say, oh yeah, that's really cool. Cause that's what a hipster is. Oh yeah, that's cool. I like that. That's cool. But if you go a little deeper and you get more into it, you're going to benefit like just so much from just even just taking that one tango class or that one cooking class.
Or just to be challenged in doing something that you don't do usually, you know?
Yeah.
Start a new path. Yeah.
Yeah. And then, you're going to be challenged. Your brain is going to be fresh. You're going to learn a new skill, a new language, like whatever, you know? But because it's so easy now to just have all the information and think that you know everything, but you actually, you don't really know very much. You just know about things.
You know? Yeah, it's like a superficial like knowledge. Yeah.
So, I encourage people, especially now, I think it's more important than ever to actually, you know, put the phone down and like do something, whatever it is you want to do.
Yeah, because also we have so many powerful tools to, you know, realize that you just need to sit down. We just need to sit down, like, and, you know, put the ideas out. No, the ideas are missing because we have tools, but we have no idea. We are losing the ideas.
That's true.
Yeah, are losing, like, the originality of that. Yeah,
and they say, like, our brains are actually, people that are really doing a lot of digital stuff, like, our brains are changing because we're too stimulated, you know, and our long-term memory is going, and we're overstimulated, you know. So, I mean, I still like to read, like, books, you know. I sit down and it's like really nice. Even magazines. I love the New Yorker. I read the New Yorker every week because I just, I don't read it online. I read it in the magazine because it's nice. It's like relaxing.
Yeah.
Anyway,
what are you?
I thought this was a music show.
No, it is a music show, but you know, like the Latin say, verba volans, no? So that we start talking and then we go.
Yeah.
So are you working on something right now in your studio? What's in your
room? Well, I just finished the thing that came out, and then I'm doing a secret remix for artists that I can't talk about right now.
Okay.
But there is a new project.
There is something in the
Stuff going on, very well known people. And then I'm going to do the Aslan 2, and it's going to come out this summer.
Okay. So this summer is
now, basically. Yeah. It's going to come out like late summer.
Okay. Yeah.
And then I don't know what. Then maybe back to World of Sound. I'm also, I'm editing some more footage. There's always something.
Always something. Yeah. You got to do it. So
yeah, there's always something. So yeah. And then I have another track coming out at end of what month is this? May. That's actually a redo, like a new version of a tune I released a little while ago, coming out on Cafe Anatolia. It's like a small European label, I think from Italy, actually.
Yeah. Okay.
And it's kind of a more ethno, kind of like more traditional, like not so much bass.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah.
And also, you teach SF Jazz, no?
Yeah.
Electronic music.
Yeah, I work in the education department of SF Jazz, and it's great. I love being there. And one of the things I do with my job is I run this little digital music studio, and we teach studio production, you know, how to record and how to mix and how to do all the electronic music stuff. So that's a really fun part of my job. Yeah. And I love teaching. It's cool.
Cool. It's cool. Like, your life is surrounded by music and creativity, you know, that's good. No?
Yeah. Yeah, you know, it's especially being a musician, it's harder because there's not that many studios, you know, in the Bay. Like, they're all in LA, you know, so I'm always like, maybe I should go back, you know, but I'm still here and I'm just doing what I can. I think maybe in the future I might go ahead and get like a, you know, professor position at a, you know, university or college or something, teaching music production or media stuff, you know. But for now, definitely surrounded.
Surrounded by music and, and creativity and doing things.
Yeah.
Cool. It's 3:42. I think it's about a good time to talk about influences.
Okay, great.
So if you had, if you ever had like a music, a song, an album that was like, wow, for you, was like, wow, you got mesmerized and you say like, stop, I want to play music.
Mm. Like early?
Early, yeah.
Okay, so I was in the suburbs in LA, Ventura County, like north of LA. And there were like these garage bands, like it was popular to be in a band, you know, in that time. And I remember once I was like a kid, like a small kid, less than 10 years old, and I heard like a band like warming up, and there was like feedback and just like drums and everything. And it didn't sound like recorded music. It sounded like weird, like what the heck is that going on? And the garage door was closed, you know? And I was fascinated, like, what is that? Because it was like electronic guitar, like music. Yeah,
feedback.
It was feedback. And I had no idea the
sound,
what the sound, you know? And then also, I had a really good friend who was my neighbor, a kid, and he had older brothers, and they were really into the Beatles, and so they turned us all on to, especially the White Album, and that Revolution Number 9 track.
Oh yeah.
And so they would like torment us. They would put us in the room and turn off the lights, and put on Revolution Number 9 like really loud, and it was scary. It was really frightening. So then I understood that sound is not, or music is not just, or sound is not just music. Like, you can have pure sound. Like, you can have experimental sound, you know? So that was that experience as a kid. And then, you know, just like Led Zeppelin, like the whole kind of, you know, Jimmy Page retuning his guitar and all these kind of like interesting kind of styles of music was very influential. But I have to say,
yeah,
it was
they had psychedelic moments. Led Zeppelin
and there was some kind of global references and some other stuff. Yeah, you know, like Four Sticks, Kashmir, sure. Yeah.
Even the Battle of Evermore. Was
yeah, so Celtic. Yeah, definitely. And then so that was very popular. You know, when I was in like elementary school or whatever. You know, the rock kind of music. But then hearing Eno. You know, for the first time, Brian Eno, for the first time, and it actually, really his ambient stuff, you know, where I was like in a house party or something, and in one of the back rooms, like someone turned it into like a chill out room, like, you know, and I walked in and it was just like this, like all this space and in the vibe, you know, like it was just atmosphere.
Instead of the kick, they
And I was like, what is this, you know? And then that kind of just led into, like, you know, you start learning more about, you know, Peter Gabriel and then Talking Heads who work with Eno, and then and then David Bowie and Eno, and there was this whole like Eno kind of like world, you know.
Also John Hassell.
I love John Hassell. Yeah, totally.
With the forward.
That weird trumpet.
Great. Yeah,
so
the
great.
Weird sound. Yeah.
And then you know, I mean, I read a lot of Eno's interviews, and then he was actually the one talking about dub and how, and then I learned about dub, and I had some friends that were really into Jamaican music, and that was kind of simultaneously going on, and then like the Clash was really into dub, you know, they had those Sandinista records and, you know, electro Clash kind of sounds, and then yeah, and then just living in LA, you like just weird kind of stuff, you know, festivals or, you know, warehouse party kind of things going on in the 80s and 90s in LA. But I really feel like that, you know, that whole kind of first wave of kind of like fourth world music or whatever you want to call it, you know, the Eno, Peter Gabriel, Talking Heads, you know, all that kind of stuff really kind of set me off in this like direction. You know, the album My Life in the Bush of Ghosts with Brian Eno and David Byrne, and then Peter Gabriel's Passion soundtrack for Last Temptation of Christ. These are just like epic moments.
Epic moments.
Mm-hmm.
Where you can just elevate your background, like rock music.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you can go and you can explore and.
Yeah, because then all of a sudden, like rock music just felt like it was only occupying like this one altitude, this one level, and then the other music was like at a higher level, you know. And then Peter Gabriel launched the Real World record label, and all of a sudden it was all this international music coming in, you know. And then he was touring with these people like Nesrat Feta Ali Khan and these, you know, Qawwali singers or West African drummers or whatever, and there was just this really vibrant, like vital sort of exchange, you know, this conversation going on, and this was like early days, you know. So I just found that whole thing to be really fascinating. And then I was lucky because I lived in LA. And as a young person, I lived in Venice Beach, and I lived next door to Tom Schnabel, who was the music director for KCRW. And KCRW is a huge station, you know, like NPR, like super influential station.
Yeah.
And so I got to hang out with Tom on air and be his on-air assist guy, and he would turn me on to music, and, you know, that was a nice period there for a while. So all that.
And that you were already making music back then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I was doing early like experiments with like looping and kind of quote unquote, you know, ethnic percussion or whatever, darbuka, and kind of like, and there was this whole kind of thing about like sampling and relooping and like kind of more just experimental, like very experimental music. It wasn't trying to be like DJ music or anything. It was just experimental, like noise shaping kind of sounds. And then I started up with this woman, Sonia Draculich, this group called Stella Mara. And that was, she and I started that group in LA. And that was kind of the beginning of this whole idea of like electronics with global sounds, with a spiritual kind of like component. And that was early days. I mean, that was like mid 90s.
Yeah.
Yeah. My first album came out in 97 or 98. So it's been 20 years now putting out records.
And counting.
Yeah. No, and I'm not. Yeah. I'm back. I'm not slowing down.
Yeah.
You know, I took a little break for a couple of years and I'm back.
Yeah. I mean, it's also it's organic to take a little break. No. Because, it's...
Yeah, I mean, you know, my studio shut down, and then I got the SF Jazz job, and I got married. And so, like, a lot of life transitions happened, you know, and things takes a while to kind of...
To reassess.
Yeah.
And,
And now, you know, I'm back.
Back and more solid.
Yeah, because, in a way, yeah. And I'm happier, too. I feel like I don't have an agenda. I'm not, like, you know, trying to, you know what I mean? I'm just doing what I do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's cool.
Cool. I keep doing it, please.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I think I'm good, you know. Yeah. Thank you, man.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for being here. It's 3:49. About to you want to play another improv on this?
I don't know. I mean, sure. Okay. Tell you what. I'll play the acoustic version. I'm going to try to sit down here if I can. Of the tune that's coming out in May.
Okay.
And cool. This is actually a tune that I wrote.
Nice.
Okay.
Is it
good?
Is it good?
It's great. All right. So this is another one that's in the five rhythm that we played earlier.
Okay.
And this is called I renamed it June Jura. So it's in Jurjuna, but it's June Jura. I just switched the syllables around. This is coming out.
Is it what the name?
June Jura, J-U-N-J-U-R-A, June Jura. And this is coming out on the Cafe Anatolia thing at the end of this month.
Cool.
Yeah, and I wrote this tune a while ago. I have to kind of remember what I'm doing here. Thank you.
Beautiful.
Thank you, man.
Jef Stott, the dude with the oud.
I am the dude with the oud.
The oud with
it's
the oud.
True.
Thank
yeah,
you.
It's great to play again. I haven't played a you know, performance kind of thing in a little while. It's nice.
It's great also with the, in a room like that. Sounds great.
Yeah. Maybe I can come back and play one of your salons here or something.
Yeah.
That'd be fun.
Yeah. 3:54, time to wrap the show
okay.
up. Thank you, Jef, so much
yeah,
for
being
here.
Yeah, it's great to see you, man. Good times. Thank good you so time. Much. I'm a little sweaty there. It's
so,
kind of hot.
So good. Check him out, jefstott.com.
Yeah.
And his latest single.
Osiris.
Osiris.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I was saying Osiris. Osiris, yeah.
And The World is Sound.
And The World is Sound, episodes, videos about, like, world music,
travel.
And traveling.
Yeah. And if you know anybody at Netflix,
if you know anybody at Netflix,
get in touch.
That's your name. let's put this show to the next level.
Right.
All right. Thank you so much. Let's close the show with a song from Aslandab. What do you say?
Sure. How about Yamaya?
All right.
I love that tune.
SoundCloud.
I'll just kind of fill in here. So this is a tune from the Aslandab system. And this is the more positive kind of tropical vibes. Yeah, the first tune there, you got it.
Yamaya.
Or Yamaya.
Yamaya.
This is the more positive kind of tropical vibes.
Shall fall when all the righteous men stand tall.